Hello, welcome to Thorlabs. My name is Brian, and today I'll be demonstrating a technique I can use to measure the retardance of a wave blade. For this setup, I'll be using a 633 nanometer fiber-coupled laser diode, a 50-50 fiber coupler, and a fiber collimator to output less than 2 milliwatts of free space light in a path that includes an input polarizer, a 633 nanometer multi-order wave plate, analyzing polarizer, a power sensor, and power meter. The other leg of our 50-50 coupler will pass through a variable fiber power attenuator before being measured with a spectrometer. I'll also be using a polarimeter to verify our results. While typically, wave plates are labeled as either quarter wave or half wave plates, the actual retardance can vary based on a number of factors, including the wavelength, angle of incidence, and temperature. If your application requires a specific or known retardance, it can be important to measure this within your system. Let's take a closer look at the setup we'll be using to make this measurement. Our laser's temperature has been set such that it outputs a center wavelength of 633 nanometers, and the fiber is connected to a fiber collimator and a tip-tilt mount, where the output has been aligned to be parallel to the table while traveling along a line of screw holes. The beam then passes through our input polarizer, which is aligned to be horizontal, or parallel to the table. This isn't necessary for the measurement, but does make our verification process easier. In order to maximize the power transmitted through this polarizer while maintaining the polarization state, we can rotate the fiber collimator within its mount until a maximum power is recorded. But first, we'll need to remove the other polarization optics. Our second polarizer acts as our analyzing polarizer. We'll insert that right before the power sensor. Now, we'll rotate it until we see a minimum power recorded. Here, we'll engage the indexing of the mount. So we have a detent where the polarizers are crossed with a 90 degree relative angle between each other. Now we'll insert the wave plate between the two polarizers, making sure to align the back reflection to the input beam, as the angle of incidence can have a significant effect on the measurement. For the measurement, we'll need the wave plates off the coaxes at a 45 degree relative angle to the polarizer axis. There's two ways we could do this. The first would be to rotate the wave plate between the cross polarizers until we measure a maximum power. The second, and the way I'll be doing it, we'll first rotate the wave plate until we see a power minimum. At this point, the waveplate's axes are aligned with the polarizer axes. So from here, we can rotate 45 degrees. We can confirm we're in the right place, as we should see the power decrease as we rotate in either direction. Before returning to our initial point. You may have noticed there's a bit of an adjustment range where we didn't see the power change on the power meter due to a lack of significant figures. This is why I always try to reference my alignment to a minimum rather than just a maximum. In order to take the retardance measurement, we'll need two power measurements, one when the polarizers are crossed, and one when they're parallel. They're currently crossed, so we can note down the power right here. Now, I can use the indexing mount of the analyzing polarizer to rotate at 90 degrees and take a measurement with the polarizers parallel. With these measurements, it can calculate the retardance for this wave plate for a 633 nanometer input source. In this case, it looks like we're a bit above a quarter wave, but still within the expected range of this wave plate. To verify this, we can swap in our polarimeter for our analyzing polarizer. For a true quarter wave retardance, we would expect to see circular polarization measured by the polarimeter, as the wave plate's optical axes are at 45 degrees relative to the polarizer's axis. In this case, though, we can see we're measuring an elliptical state. We can also calculate the expected polarization state based on our measured retardance, and we can see that lines up well with what we're measuring on the polarimeter. If your application requires an exact quarter wave of retardance, and the wavelength isn't critical, it may be possible to tune the wavelength of your source until a true quarter wave retardance is observed. In our case, the retardance was a bit too high at 633 nanometers, so we could look at a typical wavelength versus retardance plot and adjust accordingly. We know for a true quarter wave, we would see the power remain constant while the polarizers are crossed or parallel. We can then continue to tune the wavelength of your source until the power remains constant as we rotate the analyzing polarizer. Let's insert our analyzing polarizer back into the path now. And we'll rotate it to its crossed position. Based on our last measurement, we know that this was the higher power of the two. So we know that a decrease here will correspond with getting closer to a true quarter wave of retardance. If I increase the temperature, we do see the power decrease. So I can continue moving in this direction. I'm also being mindful to allow the actual temperature of the diode to keep up with the temperature set point. I'm waiting for the power to stabilize a bit at this temperature. Now the power seems pretty stable, so I'll rotate the analyzing polarizer. Now the powers are about the same. Now the polarization after the wave plate should be circular. Again, we can check this by rotating the analyzing polarizer 360 degrees, where we should see no real power change. If there is still a change in power, we can continue to iteratively tweak the temperature until the power does remain the same. We can confirm our results again by swapping in our polarimeter. With the polarimeter, we can confirm we are getting circular polarization. We can also check the spectrum to see the exact wavelength we're getting the true quarter wave out of our wave plate. To further emphasize the wavelength sensitivity of these wave plates, we can move the wavelength further out to around 635 nanometers by further increasing the laser's temperature. one could assume that 635 nanometers is close enough to 633 that we wouldn't see a significant difference in performance. However, if we take a look at the polarization state as measured by the polarimeter here, we can see just how elliptical it is. We can also swap back in our analyzing polarizer to measure the specific retardance we're getting. And now we can once again take measurements with the polarizers crossed and parallel. Can use these measurements to calculate the retardance once again and see just how far we are from a true quarter wave. In this video, I demonstrated a technique that can be used to measure the retardance of a wave plate using two polarizers and a power sensor, while not requiring the wave plate itself to be rotated. With this technique, as well as by temperature tuning our laser diode, I also showed the wavelength sensitivity of a multi-order wave plate. While all wave plates will be sensitive to wavelength change, this is most evident in multi-order wave plates. Zero-order wave plates are designed to be less sensitive to things like angle of incidence, temperature, and wavelength. Regardless of the type of wave plate you're using, it can be important to measure its retardance within your setup. I hope this is helpful in the lab someday. Please reach out to tech support if you have any questions.